Greetings. The foundation of this series is the definition of delusion. Delusion is believing something false, even when presented evidence refuting the false idea. Delusion is not the false thing that is believed. It is the state or condition of believing the false information. 1 Peter 4:17. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? Before speaking against secular falsehoods, errors, and lies, it is appropriate to first remove the beam from our own eye. The strong delusion is going to condemn people to believe false information. There are multiple sources of such false information. It can be a simple error, a misunderstanding, or bad logic, a faulty worldview. This is true in the church, in the Christian world, and is evidenced many ways. This is one reason denominations arise and churches split. But to avoid triggering internecine squabbles, I'm going to limit any critique to two critical problems. The first is a damning doctrine that has crept into the church. Replacement theology. Basically, replacement theology is an error that replaces Israel with the Christian church. I even once visited a church where the speaker said, "Every place the Old Testament uses Israel, you can substitute the word church." My wife recalls how animated I was in my seat, talking to myself. "That's just wrong. No, 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 no." I imagine those around me thought I had a demon, bothered by deep spiritual Christian truth. I never visited that church again. You may not have had such an experience or heard such teaching, but it is problematic for several reasons. First, the church does not replace Israel. We join Israel. Romans 11:13. I am speaking to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry, in the hope that I may provoke my own people to jealousy and save some of them. For if their rejection is the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? If the first part of the dough is holy, so is the whole batch. If the root is holy, so are the branches. Paul tells the Gentiles the Jews rejected Messiah to bring reconciliation to the world. For if their rejection is the reconciliation of the world, Paul also warns the Gentile church to not be arrogant. In verse 19, you will say then, branches were broken off so that I could be grafted in. That is correct. They were broken off because of unbelief. But you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but be afraid. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. And Paul addresses the return and the salvation of Israel. I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers, so that you will not be conceited. A hardening in part has come to Israel, until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. A hardening has come to Israel, or perhaps was put on Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. Until. That means it is for a time. It is temporary. More than that, it is for a purpose. And so all Israel will be saved, as it is written, the Deliverer will come from Zion. He will remove godlessness from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. If in your mind you just heard, but not all Israel is Israel, hold that thought and continue to listen. God said he would remove godlessness from Jacob. And so all Israel will be saved, as it is written, the Deliverer will come from Zion, he will remove godlessness from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Remember, it is God who takes away all our sins. The salvation of Gentiles comes with no intrinsic value or effort of our own. The second issue with replacement theology is it fosters a calloused attitude toward Jews. They had their chance. It's their own fault. If only they were not so hard-headed. Such rationalization and anti-Semitism in the church should never be found. Remember what Paul said. In the hope that I may provoke my own people to jealousy and save some of them. Paul did not see his mission to Gentiles as abandoning the Jewish people. Paul saw it as a way to make them jealous, to provoke them to desire righteousness. It was never to mock or hurt or demonize or persecute them. I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying, as confirmed in my conscience in the Holy Spirit. I have deep sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ, for the sake of my brothers, my own flesh and blood, the people of Israel. The people of Israel, theirs is the adoption of sons. Theirs the divine glory and the covenants. Theirs the giving of the law, the temple worship and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs. And from them proceeds the human descent of Christ, who is God over all, forever worthy of praise. Amen. The third issue with replacement theology is it undermines all rational eschatological interpretation. If you could replace Israel with church, what does the vision of the dry bones by prophet Ezekiel mean? What is the nation that will be born in a day, Isaiah 66:8? What does one do with the promise in Genesis of an everlasting covenant with Isaac? The fourth issue with replacement theology is it makes Jehovah God a liar. What does one do with the promise in Genesis of an everlasting, without end, covenant with Isaac? What does one do with the promise in Genesis that Israel is an everlasting possession of Isaac? But there is an even more queer failure with replacement theology. If it results in literally replacing every reference to Israel with a reference to the church, what does one do with the harsh judgments against Israel, against Jerusalem? How do you apply the 70 years Israel was in captivity? How do you apply that to the church? No doubt, replacement theology makes one feel good, but it simply does not make sense, nor does it align with Scripture. The second damning doctrine beyond replacement theology is simply the abandonment of Scripture. I call that Reader's Digest Christianity. Do you ever go to church and never have to take a Bible with you? Because the sermon never mentions a verse from the Bible? My hope is that most who follow my channel do so because they place value on the scriptures. But while it is good to watch channels that do teach the Word of God, it is important you read for yourself. Check my references. Look up every scripture I cite. Look up different versions of it. Feel it. Discern it. Listen to it. I do not hurl this as a judgment, but a cautionary warning. We are to love the truth to avoid the strong delusion. We are to study so that our hearts know the truth. If I ever teach something that ignores the Word of God, let me know. 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Psalm 119:11, thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. Examine yourself, for only you know your heart and know the spirit within you. I have been judging myself and found myself wanting. I confess I've been struggling with anger recently. The leftists are evil and are growing in their evil. I see no rational basis to think America can survive even until the next solar eclipse, before more shooting occurs in our civil war. I say more shooting because shots with real bullets have already been fired by the left. Remember the 2017 congressional baseball shooting? A 10-minute shootout ensued between the shooter, James Hodgkinson of Belleville, Illinois, a left-wing activist. Time is short. Love the truth. Our faith is in God, and not America. Learn what God has said will happen. This prophecy thing ain't no stopping it. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.